This is the Detroit Sports Podcast Network.
The biggest icon in podcasting.
Welcome in, everybody, to this week's edition of the Doc and Jock Wrestling Podcast. I'm your host, Adam the Jock Straczynski. On today's episode, we've got a lot to get into. WWE is hot on the tails of some AEW talent. We're going to tell you who, as well as what's going on with this star being away from WWE for another long-term time. We're going to get into all of that, as well as we're going to take a look at what took place with the AEW Revolution pay-per-view. We're going to get the results of that and who won the results, the predictions. And, of course, we're going to take a look at WWE. And I think WWE did a lot of good things this week, and I want to bring in the Doc, John Macron, right now. Doc, this was a really jam-packed week of wrestling, and I think WWE really took the crown, and I think there's a lot to get into, especially with what took place on Monday Night Raw. What was your takeaway from this week in wrestling?
I know, cuz some people take more vacations than you do. My God, when you have these wrestlers, they're like, maybe for, and I think it's true. I think now, looking at it, if I was a superstar, I wouldn't really be going for the money. I'd be going for the performances. I'd be saying, look, I want to work 25 dates a year. I want to get paid like 250 grand, and I don't want to spend my whole life on the road. Because if you look at it, if you kind of can get your name out there, you have a little bit of leverage. I think the leverage is not in the dollars. The leverage is in the ability to potentially say, I want to work way less, and then you can work until you're 46 in a variety of roles. And I wonder why some of these wrestlers are doing part-time things. I'm curious to see who it was that's going to be taking some time off. But absolutely, it was a stellar week. Starting with Sunday with the pay-per-view with AEW, it rolled right into Monday Night Raw, and I was just absolutely thrilled with how they played it all up in regards to John Cena's return. You had a great opportunity to see a living legend and the pop that he got, his true emotion of still feeling like, okay, the fans are behind me. But I will say this, when everybody knew the buildup was going to be John Cena versus Austin Theory, I didn't think the way in which they would kick off that build would be John Cena completely undressing Austin Theory, to the point where, as I was watching it, I just kept saying to myself, what is there to believe in with Austin Theory? He had no comebacks. And if the purpose was to completely undress one of your performers, you made him so devalued in my mind. He looked like far less than an NXT superstar in the ring with a Hall of Famer. It should have went down completely different. Or when that is presented to Theory, he's got to be like, I'm getting completely dressed down here. My value is completely being mocked, not only professionally, but as a man. I might have nixed the penis jokes. I mean, come on. When you're out there and this guy's going to be slapping at my dick and then going, hey, you need to really work on that. Not only does that devalue you as a character, but it devalues you as a person. And Austin Theory's comebacks were so bad that it made it look like this is a punk stepping in the ring with a Hall of Famer. Now, I know that's the perception, but you need it, I think, because Cena's already established, and I know Cena gets the first salvo, and maybe he's going to put over Theory at the pay-per-view, but at the very least, I think that Theory should have been presented in a much different way. He looked really bad, and I don't know if he can come back from it.
Yeah, in my notes, I have Jock finds it hard to work with him. And look, I love John Cena. John Cena is one of my favorite wrestlers. Every time his music comes on, I'm usually doing the dance. I'm usually doing a song. I'm usually all over the place. I love John Cena. I find him incredibly difficult to work with, especially with younger talent. And this is Austin Theory's first chance at really working with one of the big names. And yeah, John Cena is going to put him over at the pay-per-view. But you got to build to that point. You got to be able to go toe-to-toe with John Cena. And this is the thing about John Cena. John Cena doesn't ever really dial it back for anybody. Like, nobody. He believes iron sharpens iron. So if you're Austin Theory, you've got to go in and you've got to bring some of your best stuff, because John Cena basically backed up the bulldozer and just buried him. Like, and it was one of those things where I think John Cena was trying to give him outs, but Austin Theory didn't really take them. And if you're not going to take them and you're not going to come at John Cena with everything you got, it's not going to be good for you. It's not going to be easy. His comeback was, you've got a bald spot. And John Cena was like, all right, cool. I got a bald spot. That's the best you got. This was uncomfortable at times to watch, because Cena was so on point and so on fire and basically made a mockery of everything that Austin Theory has done up until this point. It was pretty brutal to watch. And if you're Austin Theory, yeah, you'll get the win at the pay-per-view. And yeah, on Monday night, you'll be able to call and be like, I beat your guy. I beat the people's champ. I did this. I did that. But it doesn't really matter, because you got to get to the build. You got to get people believing that you can actually go toe-to-toe with him, and that the bookmaker is not going to be the one that's going to give you the W here. And their first encounter, that didn't really work. That didn't really play out. John Cena completely annihilated him. Like I said, for me to watch that, being a huge John Cena fan, I was totally uncomfortable watching it. And it was difficult, man. It was really, really tough. And I thought Monday night had a lot of really good stuff. Monday night had the build up to John Cena. It basically had John Cena burying Austin Theory. But we also finally got a little bit of resolution with Sami Zayn and Jey Uso. I want to know how you would have made the swerve that we got between Jey Uso and Sami Zayn even better, because I thought it was great, but I felt like you could have maybe have possibly tweaked it just a little bit. And what I mean by that is, I thought everything that we got with Jey coming through the crowd, Jey going into the ring, and Jey standing face to face with Jimmy and them having a moment, and Jey basically holding Jimmy's shirt down, like just being like, I don't want to do this. The fact that you're forcing me to do this makes me really upset. He ends up walking past Jimmy and they basically shoulder bump, rolls out of the ring, and then he goes down, stands across from Sammy, and they basically have an embrace. You can see he whispers something to him, but they have an embrace. They throw up like, we're the ones, and then you can hear Sammy basically saying, Jimmy, it's not too late. Basically, we can save you. Only for Jey to basically turn and put the boot into Sammy's face. Now, the way I would have done this just a little bit different, because I think there's a bigger story at play here. I think there's more going on. Now, this is just me. I don't know. This could all be just me fantasizing this, right? It could just be me making it all up. But I think there's a bigger story at play. I think what happened with Jey and with Jimmy was Jey saving Jimmy. Roman Reigns had come out and basically said, hey, if you don't get Jey back in the bloodline, it's your ass. Jimmy has been against Roman for ever and a day. If you go back, you look at Roman Reigns' title defenses. One of those title defenses was against Jey Uso. And that was the only way Jey Uso joined the bloodline. I think there is the bloodline storyline that we are talking about. And then there is a more massive storyline that is actually at play here. I think this is fantastic creative work by WWE. This is like incredibly long-term storytelling. Probably, I think, 3 or 4 years worth of storytelling here. This is an epic story if this is what ends up playing out. And this is how I would have done this. Jey rolls out of the ring and goes to Sammy, gives him a hug, basically says whatever he says to him. And then just before he turns on him and gives him the boot to the face, he would have said something like, I don't want to have to do this, but I have to do this. Kicks him in the face and then grabs him and is like, I have to save Jimmy, and then throws him in the ring, and then they beat Sammy down to close out Monday Night Raw. How would you have tweaked it, or would you not have tweaked it at all, because you like what's going on? Because in my mind, and I could be completely wrong here, I think there's a bigger story at play, and I think Jey going back to the bloodline was one to save Jimmy. I think Sami Zayn might possibly be in on trying to salvage Jimmy. This was my whole thing as I watched this kind of unfold Monday night. This is where I was at, and I was like, I kind of love this. I love this storyline. I think this is fantastic. What would you have done different, if anything?
Yeah, thinking about it, I did not really think about tweaking it. I loved it. I thought that the crowd really ate it up and were like, holy shit. And they were really into it. They really bought in. They were so excited that maybe Kenny's idea, even as far-fetched and crazy as it came through, Jay and Sammy doing something with Solo and Jimmy at WrestleMania. That was crazy in my mind, but Kenny kept throwing it out there into the universe. So when it happened, my first thought was, damn, that Kenny maybe has a future in this kind of thing instead of being so outlandish. But then it was perfect when he backed up. I thought first visually it was funny because there was kids there and Jay's cussing, and it was kind of funny, the two kids right there near it. But the only thing that could have been different was you have Roman Reigns there, or you have him doing something, or maybe you have Jay make that decision, then Roman's music hits, and Jay has this moment where he's like, fuck, I'm being manipulated, where you clearly see he's torn doing it, but he does it. Where he does, just Roman comes out, he stands there, and just the visual presence of Roman and Paul just standing there, no words, the music comes out, Roman's arms are folded, and he looks at Jay, and subliminally he knows, oh shit, I got to do this. And then boom, he destroys him. And you still play it out in regards to Jay is torn. You can kind of get more out of it. But man, it was beautiful storytelling, cinema. Everybody loved it. And it's continuing one of the best storylines of all time. And it continued over on SmackDown.
Yeah, and it really did continue over on SmackDown. And on SmackDown, I think you got a little bit. You got a little bit of a taste of kind of where Jay is. And I kind of want to get your thoughts on how they did end SmackDown and the progression of not just the Bloodline storyline, but now you've interwoven Cody Rhodes, because Cody Rhodes was the one who came out and made the save for Sami Zayn as the entire Bloodline was beating him down as Solo. You had Jimmy and Jay just working Sami Zayn. Cody Rhodes ends up coming out, making the save for Sami Zayn. So now he is intertwined in this story as well. And again, I think this is a really good job by WWE. You know, there's a lot of times we crap on WWE. I think it's a really good job. WWE found themselves in a really tough spot where everybody was so far behind Sami and everybody was pushing Sami, wanted Sami. You had to walk a very fine line because you did not want to turn the fans against Cody Rhodes, because as much as they wanted Sami, you did not want them to not want Cody as well. So they've done a great job playing this out and basically getting Cody Rhodes to WrestleMania and not having the fans turn on him. And Sami Zayn has basically gone from being the guy that everybody wanted in the main event to the guy now that everybody thinks will probably main event day one, and you'll get a story and everybody's going to be happy with it. And whatever you get from Sami Zayn, everybody's going to basically be happy with it. Instead of it had to be Sami Zayn. If it wasn't to be Sami Zayn, everybody's going to crap all over it. So now you work Cody Rhodes into this storyline as well. I think this is fantastic. I think what they did to finish SmackDown on Friday night was great, because you've had weeks, you've had months. It's been a lot of verbal stuff between Cody Rhodes and Roman Reigns, Cody Rhodes and Paul Heyman, Cody Rhodes and whomever. It's just been a lot of verbal. We haven't really taken it to that next level. You really haven't put the car in gear and gotten it out of the driveway yet. You've just talked about driving the car. This Friday, they actually put the car in gear. There was some physicality that unfolded between Cody Rhodes, Sami Zayn, and the Bloodline. There were punches thrown. There was a little bit of bloodying that happened. And you needed this. You had to finally get the car out of the driveway, and you had to see if you could do something with it. And they finally did it. And I thought this was the perfect step forward. This was taking it up just one notch. There's sometimes where you just ratchet it up so much where all of a sudden you go from 0 to 60 and you're cruising. This wasn't that. This was basically backing it out of the driveway and driving down the street at 10 miles an hour. This was just turning the dial just a little bit, giving you a little bit more, keeping you just engaged enough and keeping you on the edge of your seat and keeping you hooked, wanting more and more and more and more. This goes back to the storytelling that we used to get during the Attitude Era, where you would end up getting Stone Cold Steve Austin, you get Vince McMahon, and they would end on a cliffhanger, and you'd have to come back the next week. You'd have to come back and see what's going to happen next. This is what they gave you on Friday Night SmackDown. This is how they closed the show. They gave you a little bit of physicality between Cody Rhodes and Sami Zayn teaming up against the Bloodline, and it makes you want to come back, whether it be Monday or whether it be Friday night. They make you want to come back. I thought this was an absolute epic way to close SmackDown and to help get you going on that road to WrestleMania. What did you think about the way SmackDown closed?
Absolutely. I thought it was stellar, well written, well done, intriguing. And again, the part with Cody is subtle, but you potentially are beginning the initial feuds of what happens should Cody Rhodes become the champion. Does Sami Zayn now take the next step? What do the Bloodline do? Do they now? You now basically inherently have four opponents for Cody Rhodes for the next several months. Jay, Jimmy, Sammy, Roman in a rematch, hopefully at SummerSlam. I'm loving the way in which you just got to include Cody in the way in which you elevate him. He's a face, and so what do faces do? They help those that are getting beaten up. Now, the question I got to ask you was, rewinding to Raw, when John Cena eviscerated Austin Theory, was it a little bit forced for him to then basically pass the torch metaphorically to Cody? I thought that moment could have been done bigger and probably could have been done at WrestleMania or the night after, where you have Cody potentially talking about being one of the greats, being a mentor, loving the fact that he back in the day he learned everything from John Cena. Then Cena's music comes out and just Cena walks down and raises his hand. You could have did it much more monumentally than you did. It just kind of was like Cena gets over, rips apart one of the performers, and then, hey, I want to prop up Cody Rhodes, which was like, you did a cheap pop just to get his music played. I thought you could have made the moment so much bigger, but I get the, basically, Cody doesn't really need it. He's a big star by himself with his efforts in the ring. I think now what you're seeing is kind of the WWE influence where we're like, we got to do just a little bit extra to get this guy believable. We have the pancakes, but we need the syrup and the whipped cream and a little bit of the cherries. And you're like, dude, it's good. This is good. This is a great breakfast. And you're like, no, we got to add a little bit of bacon and sausage. And you're like, God, it's a little bit of overkill. This is beautiful. It's already sugary and delicious, soft-ass pancakes. I don't need all this extra shit. But WWE is doing a lot of work, potentially, to offset maybe the love that the fans are giving to Sammy.
Yeah, I thought it was a little bit weird. I thought that was a little bit forced. I didn't think that was needed. I didn't think that really did anything. This is sometimes what WWE does do. They end up over-scripting everything. They kind of end up just getting in their own way. And I kind of feel like that's what happened there. Like, the whole thing was John Cena is supposed to be passing the torch to Austin Theory, not Cody Rhodes. And if that's what you want to do, you can do that. But I don't necessarily know how that makes anything better. Like, and I would have to look, and I'd have to see what Cody Rhodes' age is and what Cody Rhodes and what Austin Theory's age is. But I'm assuming that there's at least a 5 to 7 year gap between them, just off the top of my head. Not 100% sure, but just off the top of my head. I don't know why you would be giving it to the passing, and I'm using finger quotes here, metaphorically, passing the torch to the older wrestler. Do you know what I'm saying? I thought it was a nice moment that they had. I thought it was a nice embrace. I thought whatever John Cena said to Cody Rhodes was great. I thought it was awesome. Like, Cody Rhodes, as you say, deserves to get his flowers, right? Cody Rhodes has done a ton. Cody Rhodes has taken some of the worst gimmicks WWE has ever given him, and he's made them work. He ended up leaving to go get better. He went on the indies and he was the guy. He was the guy for about a 2-year span. He ended up forming a wrestling organization with his buddies after Dave Meltzer basically said nobody else will sell out a 10,000 seat arena. He basically sold out a 12,000 seat arena with his buddies and a bunch of indie guys, and then was able to sell that and pitch that to Tony Khan, who we're going to get into AEW because I think Tony Khan does some good stuff. I think Tony Khan does some bad stuff, and it has been a bit of a shit sandwich lately. But he ended up doing that with his indie friends. And I love the reference a couple weeks ago that he made about that. And then he basically, things just weren't really working out. And it was, whether it was he wanted more power or whether it was whatever, he made the decision to leave and then go back home. Goes back to WWE, and he's one of the hottest things in wrestling right now. He is fantastic. This guy has done incredible work. I don't necessarily think you needed that moment. I think the fans will kind of tell you who the fans want and what the fans want, and that's kind of where it should be left. I don't necessarily think that was necessarily needed. Something that struck me as a little bit odd, we got this on SmackDown. I've been wondering when we're going to start getting our introductions for who's in the Hall of Fame. I mean, WrestleMania is closely approaching us, but we got our first our first entrance into the WWE Hall of Fame, and I thought this was weird. And Kenny might be right. You might be right. Everybody might be right. I might just be a little bit ambivalent here. I'm not sure. But Rey Mysterio is the first inductee into the WWE Hall of Fame. What I find weird about this is Rey Mysterio is still wrestling. Rey Mysterio is still an active wrestler, yet he's getting inducted into the Hall of Fame. That to me is strange. That to me is weird. What do you make of this? What do you think of this?
Rey's going down, baby. Rey's career is about to be over. And it's true. I mean, what a culmination of a career. I mean, the man's old. And you look at it, he's been doing so many great things. And what a way to highlight somebody and tell them, look, in a way, it's time. He's 48 years old. This year, he's going to be 49. So he's winding it down. And I think it's a great way to honor him. And potentially, maybe he goes over at WrestleMania. But what a way to potentially wind down his career. This is probably going to be his last calendar year. And it shows appreciation to a character that's still in the ring. I think he likes that. He's had a storied career. And his last run with WWE, while not the greatest, it wasn't as bad as maybe some would have thought. So I'm impressed. I'm curious to see who's next. For me, though, I have to say, I think I saw it, and you can correct me if I'm wrong. I marked out the Great Muta potentially being in the WWE Hall of Fame, if I saw that right, if that was accurate. It just sent me down the memory lane of the true love I started with WCW. I had love, obviously, with superstars watching WWE, but Muta Sting, Muta Flair, Muta was kind of the ultimate first heel when you looked at, oh my God, I'm kind of scared of this dude, when he would come out when you're still young and you're 9, 10, and you're like, holy shit, the Great Muta's out and he's going to blow some mist in someone's face the way they presented him. I was a big fan of Muta, and if he's going to be out there at WrestleMania, I'm gonna mark hard a little bit more than Rey Mysterio.
I did not see that, but that would make sense if Muta is going to get inducted. If you remember his last match with Shinsuke Nakamura, so maybe WWE works something out. We're like, hey, let us introduce you. We'll give you Nakamura. There's always things going on. You know, you scratch my back, I'll scratch your back. So possibly.
Confirmed. Fightful report. Great Muta to be inducted into 2023 WWE Hall of Fame.
All right. There we go.
Great Muta, baby.
There we go. Breaking news.
Yeah, it was great. It was something that I know I saw. But, you know, there's so much information that you see. I wanted to triple check it. But, yeah, Muta is somebody that when you look at the initial heels of wrestling, that's what got me into WCW very hardcore, because those angles were told very well in WCW. Go back and watch. They're great. Go watch Starrcade, Clash of Champions. They were on par with what WWE was doing in terms of storytelling.
Yeah, they were great. Early WCW was fantastic. I loved early WCW. So good. Was there anything else from WWE that really stuck out or really caught your attention this week before we transition into AEW and get into AEW Revolution?
No, just great stuff. Seeing Cody and Kevin kind of talking a little bit backstage. I think that obviously I'm curious a little bit of how Gunther, Sheamus, and Drew is going to play out. I'm so disappointed with Brock Lesnar and Omos. It's just really, it's hard to say that a feud can get less desirable every week, but it's getting less desirable every single week. It makes you go, I want to see this less every time they talk about it. So I'm curious to see how it's going to play out. They evolved the women a little bit with Charlotte and Rhea. I didn't think the promo was that great between Charlotte. I thought that,
you know, that was a bit of a clunker too.
Yeah,
when that promo ended, I was like, that was not Charlotte's best promo.
No, exactly.
That was not very good.
Yes, it definitely did not do enough. I mean, yeah, it didn't hit. It didn't bite. It just felt formulaic and kind of a promo just to do one. But it didn't hit the mark. And I'm sure they'll do a little bit more with physicality. So we'll see what happens. The other thing, too, is I'm not really – to me, I'm curious, but I'm just not that invested in the man and Lita together. It's just a weird vibe, and it just feels like they could have went a different direction. I see what they're doing with the tag belts, but they got to do a little bit more to bring the tag team up to snuff in the women's division. So I'm curious to see how the next week plays out for WWE, but they had an A week. So let's get into AEW, because they Revolution was awesome. I loved it top to bottom. It did not drag. For me, like I said in our group chat, I thought the card placement was perfect to get you in and out. Pauses, realistically, you probably could have put one match more on the pre-show to shorten the pay-per-view. You really didn't need Samoa Joe and Wardlow on the main card. You could have put them in the pre-show with the trios match, and it would have been perfectly timed. But overall, it was fast-paced. I didn't fall asleep. I watched the whole thing. I was into it top to bottom, and I thought it was weird because the way in which that show went down, it just had a feel like it was completely separate from the shows that we've been seeing before. It was like this whole great thing of wrestling, decent storytelling, decent outcomes, whereas the television product just kind of has been far less than what we got. It's just too far of a gap. Like, your shows don't have to be pay-per-view quality, but they can't look so despairingly different that AEW's pay-per-view was like, wow, this is great. And then your television's like, probably rather read about it.
Yep. No, exactly. That I think is the best way to put this. And you're right. I think you could have put the Wardlow Samoa Joe match on the pre-show. Would have been better. That pre-show was a little bit wonky, a little bit weird, but it was what it was. Let's get into it. 0 hour match. We had Mark Briscoe and the Lucha Brothers. They defeated Mark Sterling's crew. No big surprise there. Ricky Starks, Chris Jericho. I thought they had a fantastic match. I thought this really helped elevate Ricky Starks. He ends up pinning Chris Jericho to get the win. Jungle Boy hits a concerto to knock out Christian Cage before rolling him into the grave and getting the win. What did you make of when Christian Cage got rolled into the coffin, and then Jungle Boy shut the coffin lid and the whole coffin just kind of collapsed and just fell? I seen a couple of different memes. I thought it was kind of funny. I thought it was a nice touch.
Yeah, it was nice. I thought the right person went over. I think Christian did enough work to put over the guy, and I'm just curious to see where Jack Perry goes from here. I thought it was the right thing to do, and it was a decent match. Christian is obviously a pro, and you just got to now continue to build Jack Perry, and let's see where this goes moving forward. But yeah, production level certain times at AEW kind of has the feel of old WCW in terms of like, hey, can we bring it up to 2023, please? A little bit more execution here, a little bit more attention to detail, but hey, it is what it is.
Then we had House of Black shocking the world, and they defeated the Elite to become the new Trios champion. I don't think any of us seen that happening. Sets up for an interesting story on Dynamite. We'll get into that a little bit later on. Jamie Hayter pins Ruby Soho in the three-way match. I have a bit of an issue with what took place after the match. The match itself was fine. It was a triple threat match between Hayter, Ruby Soho, and you had Saraya. In the end, you had Soho throw out Toni Storm and throw out Saraya. So then it looked like she was siding with Jamie Hayter and Britt Baker, only for her to then turn on Britt Baker and Jamie Hayter and side with Saraya and Toni Storm. And then they spray painted them in the middle of the ring. This is the problem I have with a lot of stuff that AEW does. They try to cram too much into too small of a window. I felt like this could have been better, and you could have did this angle just fine if you would have just let it breathe a little bit, right? If you would have just added a little bit of time, a little bit of pacing. Like, you talked about how this card was paced. There were parts of this show that this specifically needed to be paced out better. You just needed to hit the slowdown button. It feels like sometimes everything is moving and fast forward. I felt like this could have been more impactful if you would have showed Soho siding with Hayter and siding with Britt Baker. You know, after Hayter pins Soho, Hayter picks her up, they hug, they embrace, and you could see like Soho like basically tapping her on the chest saying, hey, you're the champ, you're awesome, this, that, the other thing. Lift her hand up and like kind of point to her, and then put her hand down, take a step back. And the moment she takes a step back, she then hits them from the back. And then you have the other girls come in, and the next thing you know, she is siding with basically the heels. I feel like the way that this story is progressing, it's just poorly paced, and they're not doing it justice. They're basically trying to take the old NWO outsiders approach to this, and it's just not working. If you're trying to pay homage to one of the greatest stories ever told in wrestling, you're doing a really piss poor job, and that bothers me. That's my issue with it. We'll move on. It just bothers me.
It didn't have the Hangman. It just didn't have the impact we would have wanted. And it's a good story. It'll develop. But yeah, you needed to have more impact, especially at a pay per view.
It just feels like it just misses on all levels. Like, nobody's really into any of this. You know what I'm saying? It just there's nothing big. I remember the Outsider storyline, and I just remember being so captivated by it and just being like, oh my God, I can't believe these guys are showing up. And you have to remember, WWE and WCW at the time were showing up to each other's venues.
Yes.
So like when these dudes rolled up, you were like, holy shit, WWE sent them in there and somehow they got in. And this is like there was so much going on at that time, and I'm probably my timeline's probably a little bit off, but there was so much at that time with everything that it just worked. This just doesn't work. Like what you're trying to do just doesn't work. And whether it be the promos aren't getting it over, whether it be the actions aren't getting it over. I hate the whole spray paint angle, like lime green spray paint. What? And like half the time it doesn't even look like it sticks. Like the stuff that the NWO did with that black spray paint was incredible. It was awesome. The way that they're doing this, this is like, this would be like you and I half-assing a project and being like, look guys, it's great. It's not. It is nowhere close to what it was supposed to be. It is totally half-assed. And it's frustrating. To me, it pisses me off every time I see it. I don't like it. I'm going to move on. Hangman used the chain to choke out John Moxley and make him tap. I don't know if you noticed, if basically throughout this entire pay-per-view, the Blackpool Combat Club kind of got their ass kicked this entire pay-per-view. Like everybody, all the guys. Wasn't good. But that helped give you the win on our predictions. We're going to get into that here in a moment. Wardlow chokes out Samoa Joe to become the new TNT champ. This is now his second run as TNT champ. The Guns retain their tag team belts. But at the end, something very special happened. They were confronted by FTR. FTR staying with AEW. It's been confirmed. I don't have any of the details of the contract, but it does sound like it is a bit of a long-term contract, so at least 2 to 3 years, FTR will be with AEW. Woo. Everything that they had did prior was just to throw you off the scent, and the whole WWE basically, you know, kind of teasing that was just to kind of throw you off the scent. What did you make of FTR coming back? What did you think of Dax getting his head busted open immediately? Where are you at with FTR coming back? Because I'm excited. I love their music. I love these guys in the ring.
It was absolutely perfect. I thought that they delivered, and it's good to see because you hope that they got some conversations in with the boss and saying, hey, put us in some meaningful shit. And now FTR, when they came out, it felt special, and the crowd now is ready to embrace them, and that's what we're looking for is, hey, take some time off, get your shit together, do what you got to do, and let's give them a run worthwhile, and I think that's going to happen. They're going to deliver.
I think they're going to deliver as well. MJF outlasts Bryan Danielson after the match in the presser. MJF says he is the most complete wrestler in the business, which leads me to ask you this. Do you agree? He just went up against one of the best wrestlers, like absolute wrestlers, not storytellers, not sports entertainer, one of the best wrestlers in the world, Bryan Danielson. Ended up going 60 minutes with him. They needed an extra 7 for him to come out the winner. I feel like the match itself was a little bit predictable. You kind of knew that they were going to have to go to overtime. I thought the way that the match itself ended was really interesting, where MJF softened him up through the course of the match to use Bryan Danielson's finishing move to submit him on him. I thought it was absolutely fantastic. But do you agree he is the most complete wrestler in the business? I think he's the most complete heel in the business right now, for sure. Guy can make you hate him. Guy does amazing stuff on the microphone. He looks like he's in fantastic shape. And I know a lot of people don't give him a lot of credit in the ring. I think he's a very good wrestler in the ring. I think he is fantastic in the ring. What are your thoughts on MJF?
As long as he stays properly hydrated, I think the man has a future in the business. I think that it was I think that it's a great testament to what he did. He trained. He hung toe-to-toe. The finish could have been a little bit smoother. I thought him constantly getting water was weird in the match. They did do some of those spots. Like they took like a minute and a half to kind of get going. They tried to find their avenues to get their rest, but when they cranked it up, I thought they showcased professional wrestling with a lot of the rolls, a lot of the old school feel, the psychology of the match. Bryan Danielson did his thing in regards to keeping up with the match, and you had that belief that potentially he could win. So they went 60 minutes. Obviously, the way in which they ended it was predictable with the, oh, we're going to restart this match. They've done that bit forever. Yeah. They could have did something more unique. But by and large, it's a wrestling show. We've seen it before. I was into the match from 10:40 to 11:40. I didn't waver. I loved seeing it. They kept you into it. They didn't have too many lulls. Like I said, the joke part was just MJF kind of going under the ring and keep drinking water. But I get it, man. 60 minutes, you can sympathize with the man. I mean, come on. It's taxing, and he's going full bore. So it's a testament to what he's doing. And the one thing I would have not done, you confuse probably a lot of people when you had MJF kind of do that cheap move and then get the DQ to give Danielson another pin. Because then the way in which the graphics were presented, it didn't exactly align. And then you had the announcers confusing everybody going, wait a minute, whoa. And then they didn't clearly establish it. And then they did after the fact where you're like, oh, okay, we're caught up. You didn't need to do that. I would have actually, if it was me, I just would have did one fall at the end, go 60 minutes. It didn't need to go 4-3. I think that part of it cheapened it for me. I didn't need to see it go like that. But in the end, for what it was versus what they delivered, kudos. They get an A-.
Yeah, that was the weird spot for me. All of a sudden, I'm watching it, and it's like, I think it was like 2-1. And then next thing you know, it's 2-2. And I was like, wait, where did that second pinfall come from? Like, what happened here? Like, it kind of threw me as well. I thought that was a little bit weird. I thought it was a great match, though. I thought this pay-per-view was so damn good. And you're right. It makes you wonder, how are you able to put on 4.5, almost 5-hour clinics of wrestling, yet you can't nail down your 2-hour television show?
Right.
Like, how are you able to do this and make this so compelling? But what you give us every single week for 2 hours, and then what you give us as a spinoff for 1 hour, the shit that you get for 1 hour is absolutely trash. Like, I was so upset Friday night. I'm like, why do I keep wasting my time watching this? I keep waiting for something. But I keep waiting for an addition to anything. And there's nothing on Rampage.
But Takeshka had a decent outing. At least you see somebody that you want to see. I thought Takeshka held his own.
Yeah, for sure.
But that was it. But that was for about sure. It. That was about it.
But like, there was nothing. Like, I could have got all of that on a 30-second screen grab from YouTube and would have been fine. I didn't have to waste an hour. You know, like, there are times where I'm watching Rampage and I'm like, I just want to send this rundown to John right now.
Yes,
I just want to send the rundown to him and let him go to bed. I can go to bed.
Right.
We can move on with our lives. Like, this is just a waste of time because Rampage is put together so poorly.
Very.
And then Dynamite at times, it just misses. It misses. And we're going to get into Dynamite right now. Real quick, calling the card. You get the point. We are knotted up at 1.
Yeah.
This is the closest it has been in a very long time. You get the point because of the choking of John Moxley, which led to him tapping out, gives you the win. Great call by you to pick Hangman Page. That was fantastic. And this is what I'm talking about with Dynamite and sometimes missing the boat. Bryan Danielson cuts a super somber promo basically saying he's going home. The announcers, this was so fast-paced. The announcers are basically like, yep, he got promo. All right, and on to the next thing. And you're like, wait, hold on. Like, is he leaving? Is he leaving AEW? Is this guy going someplace else? What is going on? Now, like, look, I don't believe he's retiring, which is why I have the question, where does he end up? Does he end up in Ring of Honor? He said he has to go home. Or does he end up in New Japan?
Right.
Which, again, he did a lot of stuff in Japan. And so what is he referring to as home? I believe he believes Ring of Honor is home. So does he go to Ring of Honor? And that's where I kind of think he ends up for a little bit. I think he takes a bit of a hiatus and goes there. But my overall point is, This is a big deal. This is a something that needs to be poignant and something that needs to be drilled down on. And this is something that the announcers can't just passively move on from. You, again, pacing. You're moving too quick. You need to spend a moment and you need to have the announcers have a conversation and almost seem blown away that, is Bryan Danielson leaving? Like, what's going on? Leave it open-ended. It can be a rhetorical question. What's going on with Bryan Danielson? Where is he going? What does he mean he's going home? And then pause, go to something else. Let somebody's entrance music hit. So now you're forced to move on. Don't you just move on? You know, again, just poor. Where do you think he ends up? I'm sorry. I'm pissed about the way that this was done.
Yeah, it's going to be probably where he takes a little time off and maybe even returns to AEW. But yeah, I think Ring of Honor would be a nice landing spot for him. I think it's good because obviously he had a nice feud with MJF. It got detailed. And plus, he was wrestling every week for the better part of this year. So a little time off, which is always good. I think it's good to kind of step in and out. That's what AEW's kind of been doing. And it's fair. He held his own. He did the right thing. He put over the guy to take him to the next level and a rebrand. But I still think he still fits in the card at AEW. You still have more potential with Takeshka. You have more opportunities to put over more guys or to have a run with the international title or other lower-end titles as opposed to the main event. But the one other thing, too, with the MJF match, just leave the counter on the screen. How are you going to go 10 minutes and take the counter off the screen where we don't know what's going on? I thought maybe that, you know what, it'd be good to kind of just take a shave of 2 minutes off and actually give it to 58 minutes. It was kind of funny. That's the way my mind went. But I think that, you know, Bryan Danielson is a world-class performer and everything that he did. My review, my notes for Dynamite was there a pay-per-view? That was my note because you don't have the champion come out and celebrate. You don't have a solid continuation with Jon Moxley. You just have an interview with Hangman Page. And the matches were just kind of like, it had really the feel of like, okay, we're going to put on WCW Saturday Night as if there was no pay-per-view that we had.
You just came off a great pay-per-view and you told nobody about it.
And see,
you told nobody that you had a great pay-per-view.
Exactly. It really, like, you could have at least showed a couple more highlights from the pay-per-view and remind everybody. It just felt like they just went forward and said, okay, we had this pay-per-view. And you look at the pay-per-view buys, only 125,000 or so. It still draws you over $6 million cash. But at this point, it was like a 30 to 40% decrease, I think, from last year. So you're not getting the proper wave moving forward with your storylines, and that's not a good sign. So you have AEW has the hardcore fans. They have that, but they haven't built any additional following, and that's not really where you want to be at this stage. They're still young. There's still a lot more investment they can do, but they're not trending with the new fan.
Do you remember when we were kids and WWE would basically highlight parts of their pay-per-view on Monday Night Raw? And they would be like, look, you can get the rebuy right now going and so whatever. So AEW is trying to push the rebuy thing, but they don't do anything that makes you interested in getting the rebuy.
Right.
I remember going and rebuying pay-per-views because of what I seen on Monday Night Raw. Like I couldn't necessarily afford it that Sunday, or I couldn't convince my mom to let me get it that Sunday.
Right.
But I could convince her to let me get it that Wednesday and I could watch it. Right. Like I would do the rebuy thing a couple of times. If you want to do that, you've got to tell everybody you had a great pay-per-view and you got to highlight it.
You got to hype it more. Exactly. It just felt like a racing train and we just got to get to the next thing. And it didn't really do a heck of a lot, but at least FTR, we now see some direction and the wrestling, at least on Dynamite, was a little bit better. But yeah, absolutely. It could have been done a lot better. It wasn't the best week of programming on television for AEW. They got a lot more. They got a lot more work to do moving forward. And Tony Khan's announcement, it didn't hit the mark at all for me in any kind of way.
Bro, can we not have this man just be on microphones? Can we just take the microphones away from him?
It looks like he's coming off of...
Put this guy in a room and lock it. Lock the door, put him in a closet, lock it.
It is interesting.
Why does this guy undermine his own product? Like, this is my whole thing with this whole thing. He undermines his own product. Like, what is the point of renaming the All-Atlantic Championship to the International Championship? Like, what is the point of this? This was a belt that you brought to everybody. You brought this. You said, I want this to be a belt in our company. It has zero history. There is zero behind it. You give it to Orange Cassidy, who has arguably been the best thing on your television product week in, week out. He has been the best, most consistent thing that you've had on your product. He is the one thing that if you are watching it on a bit of a delay, you will watch the entire thing. You won't fast forward. He has been the best. He has made that championship mean something. He has made that championship at least a little bit interesting. And then you go and you rename the championship. What is the purpose of doing that? Making it the international champion? Why do you shit on your own product? What was your reaction to this? Because I was watching this and I was like, this guy is a complete moron. Somebody needs to take the book away from him, put him in a closet, lock the key, and just have him write the checks. Because what he's doing is he is damaging his own product. What was your reaction to this? Because I was pissed.
Exactly. You didn't need to rename it. And you renamed it to something worse. So it's kind of like, well, WWE has the Intercontinental title. We got the International title. come on, your North Atlantic Championship was better. The name was better. So the international title sounds stupid to me. So they did it. Great. Again, that's what AEW cannot afford, is to make decisions where that ends up being worse for the fan. It just didn't hit the mark. And again, like you see, Vince McMahon was always shaved, wore a suit. Tony Khan comes out there looking like a disheveled Mark and is trying to, you know, be the common guy.
He looks like he's like a mad scientist in the back trying to concoct something all the time.
Exactly. They got to do better. And that's what AEW's got to do to step it up. Otherwise, you're going to be at 800,000 to a million viewers every single week. And I'm curious to see if they get any rub from the new show that's going to start airing soon. So we'll see. But AEW, like I said, put on a hell of a pay-per-view. Their programming, though, needs a lot of work in terms of the direction of what's shown on television.
Real quick, before we get into some news and notes here and we get into the show of the week, there were two things that were left from Dynamite, because Rampage was a complete and unmitigated disaster. Don't waste your time. One's good, one's bad. I'll save the good for the very, very end, the bad. Wardlow's second TNT championship run lasted 3 days. Now, look, I'm excited for Powerhouse Hobbs. I think he's credible. I think him with QT Marshall could be good. But it really does feel like this championship is a death nail. This championship basically derails whatever momentum you have going on with your career. How do you put a belt on Wardlow? How do you have Wardlow beat Samoa Joe only to have Powerhouse Hobbs beat Wardlow 3 days later? Just let Joe keep the belt. Let Wardlow fume and be angry. Then have Powerhouse Hobbs beat Samoa Joe. And you could do the whole thing where he just the damage he took from Wardlow really softened him up. Powerhouse Hobbs took advantage. He's now your new champion. And then you can have Wardlow and you can have Samoa Joe go back into a feud if that's what you want to do. So Wardlow can finally get his justification for getting his hair cut to honor his dad. You could do all of that. And you have you're basically utilizing three wrestlers to tell two stories. Let's go. It could be done so much better. Instead, you have Wardlow have be a champion for 3 days to then give the belt to Hobbs. What's your take on the TNT championship, I guess, is the question, because I don't even know, man. Again, just frustrated with the booking in AEW.
Good for Hobbs, baby. Get some TV time. Good for you. But yeah, it devalues a championship when you act like that. And you devalue Wardlow. It's just... that's the definition of how you take a character that you can make money with and you devalue them. That's what you do. And that's not what they're supposed to be doing. They're in the business of creating characters and moments, and you cheapen the belt, you cheapen the moment, and great. Powerhouse Hobbs is the champion on television. Good luck holding on to it.
So the good thing, we're getting a trios match.
Yeah.
You got JAS taking on... the Elite taking on House of Black. I think this is interesting. I think this will be good. I think this will be fun. It's going to be in Winnipeg. You've got Chris Jericho, who the greatest wrestler from Winnipeg ever. You've got Kenny Omega, the second greatest wrestler from Winnipeg ever. And you've got Don Callis, one of the greatest mic workers from Winnipeg ever. This looks like it's going to be a fantastic match. I'm interested in that. That will be taking place on Dynamite. Hopefully they don't shit the bed. That was the one good thing I took out of Dynamite this week. What are your thoughts on the Trios match?
Absolutely. House of Black getting over. They'll benefit from being in the ring with Chris Jericho, benefit from the work with the Young Bucks and Kenny Omega. It'll be fun, and it'll produce something that you are going to be intrigued by. I'm curious to see how the fans of Winnipeg react to it. I think they'll be fun and they'll be into it, especially with Christian Cage and other type Canadian wrestlers, Renee being there. So they'll have fun with it, and I think that they'll do a great job overall. I'm looking forward to Dynamite and seeing what they do. Even though they make mistakes, there's some things that they can build to and highlight week after week. So let's see what happens.
And then show of the week, look, I'm going to give it to Monday Night Raw. I thought Monday Night Raw was fantastic this week. I thought it was compelling. The whole thing with Cena was interesting. I don't necessarily think it was great for Austin Theory. I think the intertwining of Cody Rhodes, are starting to get Cody Rhodes into the Bloodline story. And then you finally get a little bit of a conclusion to what was going on with Sami Zayn and Jay. And I think that helps set up SmackDown, which I thought SmackDown was really, really good this week as well. But I'm going to give it to Monday Night Raw.
Monday Night Raw, best show of the week. Check it out. Don't miss it.
All right. Would you want some news and notes?
Hit me with this week's professional wrestling news and notes. What made your list?
All right, on Monday night, a report came out about Vince McMahon being at Monday Night Raw. According to Dave Meltzer, it's a bit of a situation that is not as cut and dry as the given reason why. On Wrestling Observer Radio, Meltzer said he was in Gorilla all night. So what does that tell you? He wasn't barking orders at people or anything like that, but he was in Gorilla all night, and I was told they tell you he's only there to visit John Cena. That's the story, but there's more to it than that. He's doing more than they're letting on. But the person who was in control was Levesque, obviously Triple H. It's not like he was there in charge and doing stuff, but it's not like he wasn't just visiting John Cena and saying hi to a few people and then left. That doesn't happen either. The truth is a little bit in the middle. This combined with last week's very Vince feeling Raw has a lot of people on high alert. Vince McMahon was reported to have showed up with a weird, creepy little mustache. Vince McMahon was also the same guy who said that he shaves every day to fight the beard because he didn't want his beard to win or his mustache to win. So he showed up with a bit of a mustache. So this is very multi-angled, right? One, is Vince okay because he showed up with a mustache and he looked like a weirdo? Two, is Vince basically putting feelers out to see how people would react to him being back in Gorilla? Three, is he trying to worm his way back into creative? So a lot going on there. We'll have to kind of wait and see how this unfolds. It's sometimes the stuff in wrestling, what takes place backstage is sometimes way more interesting than what actually takes place that we're allowed to see. So that is a very interesting story. Now, on Tuesday night, new AEW or former AEW TNT champion Wardlow shared a video on Twitter showing his rental car having been broken into. This sounds like this might be part of a storyline after watching Rampage. On the video, he said that his ring gear and his AEW TV champion or TNT championship belt were among the things that were stolen from his car. Wardlow on the video says, thanks to the person who broke into my rental car and took absolutely everything from me. My TNT title, my gear, my boots, my whole life were in those bags. I don't know if this means I'm going to have to beat the shit out of Hobbs in these clothes I'm wearing right now, but one way or another, I'm going to make it to Sacramento and we're going to get this shit done. Wardlow took on Powerhouse Hobbs on Wednesday's Dynamite, where he ended up losing to Powerhouse Hobbs with the help of QT Marshall. On Friday night's Rampage, they made reference to this and they're going to show you what really happened with his rental car on this upcoming Wednesday's Dynamite. So we'll have to wait and see. WWE is being told to stop it. Usually WWE is notorious for sending cease and desist letters and copywriting everything that is a wrestler's identity. Well, that shoe is now on the other foot. An independent tag team has sent two cease and desist letters to WWE over the United States champion Austin Theory's nickname. Theory has been referring to himself as the Now for several months, following his failed Money in the Bank cash-in and character shift from last year. However, independent wrestler Vic Dallison and Hale Collins have been teaming under the name The Now since 2006, with them owning the trademark for the name. Vic recently spoke on the Hudson Valley Post, noting that the team has sent two cease and desist letters to WWE. Their next step is to file a lawsuit for trademark infringement. Vic said, my initial reaction was shock because of the fact that we've had it copyrighted since 2006, and there are many people in WWE who know Hale and I, know our names, and know we own it. He continued to say, we've sent two cease and desist letters to WWE. They acknowledged one and said they would look into it. Looking into it doesn't stop them from being on TV. Our next step is a lawsuit for trademark infringement and creating confusion in the marketplace. WWE has interest in another AEW wrestler, according to Fightful Select. Brian Cage's AEW contract is due to come up very soon. AEW had wanted to extend the contract to take in injury time, keeping Cage under contract to at least the end of June. Fightful Select has reported Cage has pushed back on that with interest in exploring free agency. Fightful Select also noted that WWE has maintained an interest in Cage. According to their sources, they are open to a conversation. It's also reported that AEW offered Cage a contract extension that would be comparable to his current deal. This option hasn't been ruled out. Brian Cage is the current ROH World Six-Man Tag Team Champ alongside Kuna and Toa Laya. Cage joined AEW in January of 2020, though he wouldn't debut until May of that year at Double or Nothing because he was dealing with an injury. That's where that injury time comes in. Other wrestlers with contracts expiring soon that WWE are interested in are the former AEW Trios champs. According to Dave Meltzer, who has provided an update in the Wrestling Observer newsletter stating AEW is working on signing the Young Bucks and Kenny Omega to new long-term deals well before they become free agents. Recent reports are that WWE has a lot of interest in Kenny Omega, so it would be best for AEW to sign him sooner rather than later. And this WWE star is taking more time away from the company. Dave Meltzer commented on the status on this wrestling on this wrestler's recent absence in the new Wrestling Observer newsletter, stating Alexa Bliss is on another hiatus for a while. In 2021, Bliss took some time off from WWE in order to undergo a sinus surgery. She also had some time off in 2022, and since her return, her character really hasn't seemed to hit. So this time off might be a chance for her to recalibrate and then come back and do the stuff with Uncle Howdy and Bray Wyatt, and we'll see where the hell it goes. Nobody really knows. But Alexa Bliss isn't going to be on TV for a minute. And that's going to do it for this week's wrestling news and notes.
Make sure you follow Adam on Twitter at AdamRSTROZ. Follow the network at Detroit Podcast. If you agree or disagree with anything that you heard today, hit us up. We love having the debates, the banter, wondering where certain storylines should go on the road to WrestleMania, AEW moving forward now in 2023. Great stuff. Make sure anywhere you listen to your favorite audio broadcast, your favorite podcast, type in Detroit Sports Podcast and our content will find you. Just push the subscriber button and everything will be golden. Cause great episode. Podcasting time is over. Let's check in next week when we review everything that went down in the world of wrestling on the latest episode of the Doc and Jock Wrestling Podcast.